believe in doing what I can, crying when I must, laughing when I choose. Hi-ho, if love were all, I would be lonely.
Oh, hello, everyone, and welcome to a new edition of In Conversation With. The occasion today is the retrospective of Judy Garland, currently on at the BFI. It's 100 years after her birth, and it's Judy Reborn, we're told. So I was very excited by the program, and I wanted to talk to someone about it. So, and when I think of Judy Garland, I think of stars, of musicals, of entertainment and utopia, of gays in film. Judy Garland and gay men, of authenticity, or the evocation of authenticity and performance, of so camp as to keep us going, of all the sad young men, of whiteness. And then, of course, there's all those other pastiches and drag versions and so on of Judy. So one can't help but think of pastiche as well. Which is to say that when I think of Judy Garland, I think of Richard Dyer. And it's a great pleasure to be able to talk to him about Judy Garland in what follows. This is not a formal interview. It's not intellectual or academic. I want you to really see it as two old friends, quite knowledgeable on the subject, he more than anyone, talking about the significance of Judy Garland that is once more sparked through this retrospective currently taking place at the BFI. And apologies in advance, right? What you're seeing is a kind of an adorned Zoom call. Yeah, I didn't want to texture it in with lots of images or clips. I wanted the focus to be on the conversation. But it's a Zoom call, so be warned that at a certain point, kind of, it will just dissolve and just lead into a Judy Garland song, which is where we'll end. So be forewarned. Hello, Richard. To talk about the season at BFI. Yeah.
Right. So
it's entitled like Judy Garland 100th Anniversary, A Star Reborn.
Right.
And, you know, I thought you'd be the ideal person to talk to about, you know, the continued significance of Judy Garland as a star in its various dimensions. So I just want to, you know, to begin with any initial thoughts that you have about the season itself.
Not particularly. I mean, I didn't think, why didn't they approach me or anything like that? And no, I mean, I've been to a few things. I always feel it's a shame that they don't do complete seasons of whatever it is they're doing. It's always a selection. But, you know, I can't really fault the selection. There's nothing obvious missing. So I don't have any particular feelings about it. I'm sorry.
No, that's all right. I kind of, you know, I wasn't.
But I just, one thing though, I find this actually came up in conversation on Saturday when I was there with one or two people who said something similar to what you just said, and about how in general the season has not, I don't know if it's even mentioned the sort of gay following. And so why? And I have to admit, I thought, well, I almost want to rescue Judy Garland from the rest. It's a bit extreme that I put it that way. But I think seeing the films again after some time, really, I just think, well, she is just extraordinary as a performer. And I sometimes think that the problem with cultural studies generally, not just with gay readings, is it's liable to kind of turn it into a sociological interest. Rather than appreciating the kind of extraordinary cultural achievement of someone like her.
Yes.
So I'm quite happy that that's kind of the emphasis of the season.
Yes. I'm torn, right? So, so for example, I remember teaching, you know, some of her films, Meet Me in St. Louis or A Star Is Born, or, you know, The Wizard of Oz.
Right.
And always kind of feeling that I somehow have to insist that, you know, along with Bette Davis and Greer Garson, she was the biggest star of the war years, the biggest female star of the war years, right?
Yeah.
It wasn't a gay thing only, right?
Absolutely, yes,
Because there is this assumption that somehow she's only of interest.
Yes.
Yeah. So I've always felt I had to kind of insist on that. But now I feel almost kind of, you know, the other way around. Yeah, that it is odd for a major season at a major kind of, you know, the national film institution to not broach that aspect that actually is not only crucial to an understanding of, you know, changes in her star persona, right? Because they can all be periodized.
Yes.
You know, but that are actually, you know, an essential part of a gay cultural history. Yeah, kind
yes.
of whatever you might feel about Judy Garland individually, kind of, you know, historically, she has been a kind of a...
Absolutely, yes. Yes. No, I think that is true. Yes, I mean, maybe they should have done something. And a lot of the coverage hasn't really emphasized that. I mean, I did an interview with someone in for the Entertainment Weekly, and that was very much she wanted to talk about what, you know, the gay following and what, why it was and all that sort of thing. But certainly the press coverage here has seemed to have taken the BFI line that we just talk about her as a great star and so on, and we don't really, and they sort of mention it in passing. In fact, still with that slight feeling of it's a curiosity. Mm. When you think how mainstream sort of LGBT things are, it's sort of odd in a way to still be in that mindset of, well, it's just a bit of an oddity about I can see that, but then I have also the other fear. I'm like you, torn, because I have the other feeling, which I, when I taught Ever to Judy Garland, I think I barely mentioned the fact that there was this gay following, because I was so much wanting people to think she wasn't, I suppose this could be a kind of residual self-hatred or something, but you know, almost sort of say she isn't only of interest to gay, but she's even more than that sort of thing. Yeah. You know?
I mean, I do think, and increasingly over time, that, you know, she is increasingly extraordinary to me as an artist, right? Mm-hmm. And that has always been the thing. I remember this anecdote. I was reading some Spencer Tracy biography, and, you know, someone asked the screenwriter, you know, who is the greatest actress in The Lot at MGM? And he said Judy Garland, and Mayer fired him as the correct answer was Garbo, right?
What insight he had.
Yes. So I do think that, you know, those things should be celebrated. I mean, there's that incident in Meet Me in St. Louis, right? The dance at the end.
Yes.
She just gets laughs out of thin air, out of like reactions, right? It's quite extraordinary, really.
Yes, you know, yeah.
Those things.
I suppose the other thing is that it's very hard to rescue her in general, and also the gay response to her, from the idea that it's all about suffering and neurosis and so on. And yes, of course, that is kind of important. But when you go back to the films, even Star Is Born, but certainly the films before 1950, yes, there is a sort of, there's an emotionality and the vulnerability and all of that is sort of there. But there is a kind of magic and a glow, and she's gorgeous too. I mean, I was thinking all this stuff about she wasn't very pretty. Well, I'd love to be not as pretty as her, you know. I mean, yes. God, you know. So yes, okay, she wasn't Ava Gardner, but nonetheless, you know, I just think, again, given that they can't do everything at the National Film Theatre, I'm quite glad that there's a sense of cherishing her as a kind of glowing star presence.
Yes, I do think that aspect needs well, does it need further underlining? I mean, everyone knows she's great. The question is, how is she so?
Well, you and I know. Yeah. I mean, but I just sort of worry that perhaps other people don't know that and only know. And I never saw the film with Renée Zellweger. I just couldn't bring myself to see it, actually. But I thought, oh, why does it have to be focused on that moment? I gather it's focused on that sort of last 10 moments and so on. So I couldn't sort of quite bring, I don't like Renée Zellweger anyway, but that was a, you know, so, but actually one of the things about the NFT season, which is interesting, is that certainly the screenings I've been to has been a lot of younger people. It hasn't been kind of the old crowd who know, as it were, and who seem to be enjoying it, these younger people. So that's
good. Yeah. I mean, I was... Well, one of the things that kind of, that prompted my desire to talk to you about this was really because, you know, recently she seems more in the culture than ever, really, or at least since I've been growing up, right? There was that Broadway show, The End of the Rainbow, which also dealt with, you know, the last stages and the drugs and so on. There was the Rufus Wainwright reconstruction of the Carnegie Hall concert, you know, there was the film. Wizard of Oz and Meet Me in St. Louis and Easter Parade are holiday staple. Like, she's not like other people that have just kind of disappeared. I was thinking, and this is more from a gay context, I was thinking it was interesting in a way to compare kind of, you know, your writing on Lana Turner and Judy Garland, because kind of Lana Turner seems to have disappeared from the culture in a way. And Garland has it, and the ways that she's of interest change. Yeah. There's that Susie Boyd book. I don't know if you know it.
I haven't read it actually, but I know about it.
I
was actually on a radio program with her as well.
Yes.
At the time of the most recent Star Is Born.
It's a wonderful book, and it's very interesting because it connects to a lot of the things that you've written about in relation to Garland and gay men, right? So Susie Boyd's boyfriend commits suicide, she's going through a depression, a terrible depression, and actually it's just watching the Judy Garland show over and over and over again, Alice Manic, or that becomes a way out of that hole for her. So interesting in relation.
Yes.
Kind of what's been written about.
But I remember when I was originally working on, because I wrote a very short piece, we never got published, while she was still alive, actually. That can't be true, but it wasn't long after she died, which was all about. And I remember then there were lots of stories in the press, like a woman who learned, who was sort of had been, her legs, I don't know, she had problems. She had her legs damaged and she had difficulty walking. And it was listening to Judy keeping going in spite of everything that inspired her to learn to walk again. Mm. So, I mean, it's very interesting that it's quite wide. Is this internal homophobia, but it's not just gay men.
Yes.
It's a kind of whole range of people who might respond to that element in her.
Yes. I mean, I also, I get you, but I also don't understand why those things can't go together. You know, why in a retrospective of a star's career or a consideration of the significance at this particular cultural moment, the significance in the culture at large, and also the significance, you know, to gay culture as part of that larger culture at large.
Well, yes, I mean, I'm interested. You're convincing me in the sense that it may well be that it's, after all, the gay take up of it that has kept it going, and that has kept making that available and has articulated what was there. Because after all, who knows what gay people or anybody thought about Judy Garland before 1950? I mean, we just don't have any evidence about that. I don't know about it if we do. So whether anyone ever perceived her like that really before the kind of gay take up and the gay articulation of that, which then makes that available to all sorts of other people who might perceive that in her.
Yes, and even the gay take up thing I think is interesting. So for example, I think in one of your pieces on her, you suggest that you know, that really developed after 1950.
Yeah.
Yeah, when she left MGM after the suicide attempt, and then kind of, you know, gay men, or have evidence that gay men took a particular interest in her. Yeah, but, you know, I mean, gay men could very well have taken a particular interest in her before.
Absolutely, no, I'm sure. Yeah, no, I mean, I do increasingly think that. I think that's absolutely right. And that, absolutely, that sense of emotional, I was thinking about it, emotional, it's both intensity and vulnerability together.
Yes.
Is kind of, you know, that period, you know, we had all that churning inside us, or we must have done. and that you could have responded to that. And, you know, there is a wider history of gay men liking musicals and gay men liking movie stars. And so it's very feasible. It's just that we don't have any precise information about that. There may well be, maybe one, you know, now it's so easy, maybe someone should run a sort of search, you know, so many things are online now, many books are online, even, and you know, like I recently did the whole thing about the reference to classical music, in fact, in popular fiction, well, in fiction generally, gay fiction, or not just written by gay people. And it was because it was very easy, you just go to, there's so many of these books, even books that are not canonical or famous or not considered important, you just go there and you put in Chopin, and up you come with references. So maybe, you know, if someone will just sit down for a few weeks and work their way through all the likely candidates, they might come up with lots of evidence. But I don't know if anyone has actually done that.
I wonder if, you know, she was a significant figure to your own coming out into gay.
Oh, God, absolutely. I would almost say I learned to be gay by learning to love Judy Garland. And almost like I thought that and camp as well. I thought that's kind of what you had to do. Uh-huh. So although it was about desiring men, nonetheless, I actually dedicated my chapter to this Michael Walker, who ran a coffee bar in South London, which is where I grew up, and he had been in the theatre, and he co-ran it with a friend, who I was also very fond of, a woman, he was gay, and he kind of almost like inducted me into the sort of gay relationship to showbiz with the special place of Judy Garland in there. So it was really, really crucial, and you know, that feeling of it was a kind of reference point, and there was something more to share than simply saying, I fancy that man or something. There was almost a whole other realm to share. And when there was the restored version of A Star Is Born, was shown at the London Film Festival, which I never used to, and I still don't, I never go to the London Film Festival, but I did get tickets for that and took Michael, who was quite a lot older than me. I mean, he was about 20 years older than me. And I took him to that. So it's like, almost like a kind of sealing the kind of importance of this. So no, she was absolutely, you know, absolutely crucial. I was, of course, upset about her death, but I can't say that the relation of her to gay liberation, which is often claimed, I learned about that. I didn't experience it at the time. But I guess I was living in London and not experiencing, well, I was in some broad sense experiencing gay oppression, but I wasn't kind of going to bars and being sort of beaten up or arrested. So I didn't have, there was nothing kind of that thing, the kind of thing which really triggered the connection in the weeks after her death. So it was only later, really, in a way, partly through the gay sweatshop play As Time Goes By. And the person in that, again, I didn't point this out, but actually the person who played the drag queen in that was a friend of mine. He wrote this speech about how important having Judy Garland was, and he sort of relates that then to gay liberation. And for his experience, but I don't remember. I don't. I didn't personally experience it that directly. Because I'm just that bit older, I suppose, really.
When did the term a friend of Dorothy come into use?
I don't know. It surprised me when I first learnt it, partly because the Wizard of Oz was never an important film to me. Mm. I don't know why. I mean, I didn't see it till I was about 12. I don't quite know why I didn't, but it wasn't the film of my childhood, really. So I was almost a bit too old to see it when I first saw it. So I didn't see it as a child. Mm. 12 is a child, but nonetheless, you know, it's... So it was never that important to me as a film. And so it quite surprised me when it suddenly that was the, I mean, I accept, of course, that is her most historically most important film, as it were. But I don't know when that term first came in, I'm afraid. Mm. But it surprised me the first time I heard it.
Yes. I think I came across it in, it might have even been a novel, like Faggots or something like that, where someone goes into an S&M bar and says, oh, I don't think we're in Kansas anymore.
right. I love that bit. Yeah. I love that. There's that porno postcard, yeah, which is her saying that, and then these men in leather and all the rest of it.
So I know that A Star Is Born and Meet Me in St. Louis are favorites of yours. You've written on them very substantially and considerably. But what are favorite moments? What are moments from, different films that have had a particular significance or that you think of a special, perhaps because of her artistry in conveying?
Yes, I mean, I've seen, because I mean, I think a lot of the films, you have to sit through quite a lot in order to get to the good bits. In terms of absolute extraordinary artistry, then, I mean, it's very banal when you say it, but Get Happy,
yes,
from the end of Summer Stock. I mean, I saw that just in the season here, and I thought, because this, it's so consummate, and yes, partly in its editing and choreography, but also in her performance, the security of, and the, one of the things I think is extraordinary about her is her ability to respond to a song, and she responds melodically with her yes, movements, but she also pays attention to the words. But she can also be doing something else. So in that number, there are certain points at which the choreography has the men sort of leaping towards her, and she goes, "Whoa, what are you doing? Oh my goodness!" Or kind of a special says something like, "Oh, for goodness sake!" It's very witty,
yes,
and that goes all alongside it. And I think that ability to do to sort of, like at the end of, there's a wonderful at the end of the trolley song in St. Louis, that sudden, she's suddenly sort of, she's all exhilarated. Then suddenly there's the embarrassment of the boy next door. So she keeps the song going, yes, whilst at the same time having that. So, I mean, I think that's a wonderful quality of hers. I mean, but I particularly like her singing sad songs. I have to, I think that's the supreme moment for me is in singing, But Not For Me, in Girl Crazy. It's partly, there's also just an incredible cut apart from everything else, because she sings this actually quite amusing little intro about, don't start giving me comforting words, I'm fed up with all the Pollyanna and all that sort of thing, and then there's this cut to above, and she looks so gorgeous, those big eyes and that soft mouth, and then sings, of course, it is such a beautiful song, but it's so tender and touching it's a magical moment, absolutely. And so there are other moments that I'm always chasing rainbows in Ziegfeld Girl, which they're not showing, and which is a really interesting film, I think, and fascinating because of the contrast between her and Judy Garland and Hedy Lamarr. And even there was a little bit which I had tickets to go and see Listen Darling, but I couldn't go, which I'd never seen, and I couldn't go because I wasn't well, but I saw a little bit on TV, and she just, it's where she sings Zing Went the Strings of My Heart, and she's very young, and it is kind of magical. So much as I admire her in the acting, and she's very funny I mean, the pirate, she's very, it's a really great comic performance throughout. So she's got all of that. But it is the moments of the sad songs, or that, well, not the Sing When the Strings of My Heart isn't a sad song, but it's the moments of the songs, and particularly the sad ones. Even songs like Better Luck Next Time in Easter Parade, which is not a great song really, but it's so touching. And I think the extraordinary ability of her to be fully in the moment. It's like she's, she's not just, I don't know, it may be an illusion, it may just be, it's artistry, but you feel that she, the performer, is fully in the moment of that character's emotion. And it's a rare quality to have, I think.
I was, brushing up on this a little bit before talking to you. And it's so interesting because of all the qualities that one associates with, her star persona and so on, the one thing that is, I think, not mentioned is the intelligence.
Yeah.
I mean, the camp is, the wit sometimes is, the tragedy is, and so on.
Yeah.
But actually, those things that you're talking about, to me, is a kind of intelligence. It's a quick.
Yes.
An ability to read the moment and respond, and
the
wherewithal to respond.
But I mean, the other thing I love about her, actually, I think respond is such a good word. So although not only does she respond to the melody and the words, when it comes to action, she responds to the words she's got to speak, but she responds to the other actors. And I mean, she is the most, she's so interactive. And, and there's that famous, and now it's become such a thing of gay culture, the famous duet of her and Barbra Streisand singing Get Happy and Happy Days Are Here Again, there are an incredible number of versions of that now. There's one of the gay men's chorus, but it's just two of the gay men's chorus singing it. Mm. And then I think it's the San Francisco one. There's a version in Glee, and there's a lesbian version. I'm sure there are lots of others I don't even know about. Mm. But what's fascinating about the original with Barbra is that Barbra does occasionally look at Judy, but Judy looks at Barbra all the time and clutches her and clings to her. And of course, it's reached a point where it's needy. So you could say it's moving and wonderful. But it's also got that slight sense of neurosis or something. But then if you look back, she's like that in all the films. It's just a bit, but it's so, so responsive. And, it's a tiny little, it's like Lillian Gish is like this. I mean, these tiny little responses to what someone is saying. She's not just listening. But it's not a big, great mine of a response either. It's just a little flickers of response to someone being, like Mickey Rooney being a bit sort of bumptious or whatever it is. It's just a little flicker of response to that. And or whatever, in all the films there's that. And it is, again, it's an extraordinary ability, I think.
I mean, the thing with Streisand is that, like, they're almost opposites, because Streisand is so self-absorbed, so self-contained.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. I know.
Garland's always reaching out.
Yes, I know. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, no, it is a fascinating, I used to use it in teachings. I mean, it's a fascinating example of what body language can suggest.
Yes. The other thing that you touched on was the connection to lesbianism, I suppose. So you write about her androgyny. And I think you make a distinction between androgyny of sex and androgyny of gender. Yeah, that kind of, she doesn't necessarily evoke or represent kind of a sexual androgyny, but one of gender. Yeah. And then there was kind of, this thing about her relationship to gay men. And my understanding is that what's become clear is that she also had quite a large lesbian following.
Yes.
And maybe because of that, I mean, it is surprising how often she appears in male clothing, aside from everything else,
yes,
in films.
And then, of course, the much more cropped hair towards the end.
Yes.
Yes. I mean, I know about it, as I know, but I think you've said all I know, as it were. And you know, there was a blog, I can't remember, but which is, I forget what it's called. It might even be called "I Love Judy" or something, which is by a woman who identifies as lesbian and who actually says very nice things about me, but you know, the one thing you've omitted is a lesbian following, and she talks about that. I mean, it'd be very interesting to know whether the same features are as resonant. You know, what is there a difference in which are some numbers picked out more than others? But then a lot of things you might pick, like in between, or and particularly, that's why I get happy. And also the first number in Star Is Born, You Gotta Have Me Go With You, are fascinating because she wears the signs of male attire. But at the same time, it's very feminine, in fact, because of the, you know, the bare legs and so on. And so it's a kind of real, it's not so much, I mean, androgyny may even be a misleading word of mine. I mean, thinking about it now, I don't know what word one would use. Well, maybe even non-binary, but that would lead you in another direction.
Yes.
But it is an interesting, it's like a play on gender identity. A play on gender, which is very exultant. It's a very, and even the other side of it, which is the couple of swells. I mean, it's such an enchanting number that again, there's a kind of enjoyment of someone who is in no way pretending to be a man, nonetheless wearing men's clothes. And it's, I mean, you could say that's a very interesting. And she's not even being a butch. It isn't that, but maybe it can be read that way. Maybe that is an appeal. I don't know.
I mean, your mentioning of that number now makes me think also of her connection, of how much tramps and clowns, how much one associates that with her.
Yes.
And the
yes.
significance of that. I mean, you know, what do you think is the significance of that? Because, I mean, it really boils down to the one film and then her use of it in concerts.
But yes, well, and The End of the Pirate, of course, is the clown.
Of course, yes. One. Yeah.
So those are the two big ones. But I agree, otherwise, in the rest of the... Well, there are one or two other weird, I mean, things, of course, which I don't, can hardly bear to sort of get into. But, I mean, you know, so there is the blackface in, is it Strike Up the Band? One of the films she's in black. And even some of the, even Get Happy, you know, it's kind of a song really written for a black... The implications of it. I mean, we're going to the promised land. Well, okay, you don't have to be black to sing that. But even that, there is another line, and I forget what it is, which is much more clearly within the tradition of Negro spirituals and so on. But there's also one, I saw another one recently where it's in Summer Stock, which is doing a whole, oh, dem this and dem that. I mean, she's not in blackface, but it's using that kind of African-American dialect as it was in Hollywood. So there is a whole other thing there that I'm not sure why I'm mentioning this, but just that sense of disguise, I suppose, and tramp and clown, of course, are disguises.
I think it's very interesting because in a way you could argue that, you know, these films, particularly the ones that draw on the South,
yes,
sexuality and yes. blackface, it is a way of kind of shoring up whiteness or affirming whiteness and yet alongside that, there is, like, you know, this clown and this tramp and actually yes. even to have that associated with her is, you know, so I suppose my thought is that there is kind of an affinity with, you know, the marginal, the outsider,
but
even as it might affirm kind of whiteness, nonetheless it's doing so from a kind of a point of, I don't know, if identification or connection or just something interesting there, I think.
Right. Okay. Well, one understands that one of the people that most befriended Lena Horne in Hollywood was Judy Garland. Of course, there is a She's on one of the TV shows, Nina. I think there is that affinity, but there is also there is also appropriation,
yeah, of course.
And in relation to the African American tradition, which I don't think you can talk about appropriating. I mean, she is appropriating the clown tradition, if you like, but you know, so what? There's no, we don't feel any power grab or anything going on there, inappropriate. But yes, I think there isn't. I think that's right. I mean, the tramp is interesting because, I mean, I don't know much about it, but I think there's a whole history. Because after all, to be a tramp is, well, I've never been a tramp. What do I know? But I mean, if you think about it, it's about it's about depending absolutely on, so you sleep rough and you depend on poverty and you probably hungry half the time or more than half the time. So in theory, being a tramp is not great. And also tramps were very badly treated most of the time and despised and as being sort of not respectable and so on. But there is another tradition of the tramp being this sort of happy-go-lucky. I mean, I think there's, is it Hallelujah, I'm a Bum? There's a whole lot of other things. And of course, it's the Disney film Lady and the Tramp. There's a whole other idea of the tramp, that sort of happy-go-lucky tramp image. So presumably it's drawing on that. So it's a kind of happy-go-lucky marginal image. And that's, of course, a couple of swells is exactly that. And the clown, yes, I don't know about. I mean, clowns is, yeah. I mean, I always thought clowns are rather sinister, really. There's something quite disturbing about clowns, really. I don't think there's anything of that in the way Judy Garland takes it over.
I was thinking in relation to tramps, that the figure of the tramp in, you know, very recent post-depression America would have been a kind of an experience of many people and a well-known kind of figure and particular things, really.
Yes.
You know, one of the figures of the depression is all those tramps and trains.
Yes, that's right. Yes, that's right. Yes. You know?
So, I don't know, there's a suggestion of, there's a democratizing element, perhaps, I don't know.
Yes,
About the use of those figures. I want you to tell me a little bit about her singing. We haven't really touched on that.
Yes, I'm wondering, it's so hard to talk about singing, isn't it? It's so hard to, I mean, I very seldom listen to her. So in a sense, I'm not, you could almost say I'm not a fan. I like seeing her sing.
Yes.
And I like seeing her sing because I like the way her whole body, and not just the gestures, but everything, you know, the whole, you can see her body following the phrase and so on. So all of that, I mean, but the voice is not, compared to, you know, my favorite voices, I mean, Ella Fitzgerald or Peggy Lee or something like that, then it's not like my favorite voice at all. I mean, it's interesting that she has the range. I don't know what her actual vocal range is, but she can, you know, she's nearly on a par with Ethel Merman at one end. And at the same time, she's also able to have that kind of softness, particularly in some of the ballad singing. So there's that kind of range. I don't know what, you know, high and low range she has. And obviously she was often set up as kind of to be the voice of rhythm, which of course is interesting. It relates back to what we've just been talking about in relation to African American culture. Again, you know, the famous film she made with Deanna Durbin, where they're both singing simultaneously, very similar things, like wordless, but she's doing it in a kind of what might almost be called scat or something, whereas Deanna Durbin is more sort of, what's the word for that? You know, that extent, right. You know, that sort of coloratura,
yeah.
So, and whatever it is, you know. So there's all of that. I mean, one of the reasons I often think there's a sense of strain in the voice, which is even, I sometimes think is actually not all that attractive. When she's there in front of you, it becomes almost part of the excitement that despite the strain, here she is giving out with the song. But it's a reason why I don't really listen. She's not someone who I actually listen to all that much. Yeah. But I'm not sure I can say more than that, really. I mean, there's a kind of, at its best, it's slightly lower register. It's lower register. And she can do high, but it's not Deanna Durbin, but it's not even Peggy or Ella. You know, it's a slightly lower, almost want to call it a brown register, but what does that mean? It means something to me, it doesn't necessarily mean to anyone else. That's the trouble with trying to talk about it. But I think it's quite interesting that it's not, going back to the whole thing about in-between appeal, androgyny or whatever, that singing like Deanna Durbin or Jane Powell or Catherine Grace and all of those big, and of course, you have to remember, Deanna Durbin is a very interesting case. We're going back to Lana Turner. Deanna Durbin was a massive star. Mm. I mean, and almost, I bet most people don't even know who Deanna Durbin is, but she was a huge star. I mean, really, really massive. And had a very faithful fan following for about 50 years after she stopped making films. You know, I mean, she had incredible loyalty of fans. But you could never mistake her voice.
They're writing songs of love, but not for me. A lucky stars above, but not for me. With love to lead the way, I found more scars.